Good morning. Let's stand together and let's sing Joy to the World.
Like to welcome you here this morning. Isn't it a beautiful day to be in God's house? It really is. It's wonderful to see all of you. This is our second Sunday of Advent. And if you're not familiar with Advent, it is the Advent season that we celebrate. It isn't just about a day. It's about a season where we reflect on the love of God and how great that love must have been to send His only Son in the form of a little baby that we might have a Savior. Amen? And so we take each Sunday for four Sundays, and we celebrate and we reflect on the very blessings of God. And then on Christmas Eve, we light the very center candle, the white candle, the Christ candle, as the light has come into the world. And isn't that really what we celebrate? Is with all the darkness that might be around, it is the light that is Jesus that we celebrate each and every day. So this morning, the second Sunday of Advent, this is a poem that comes with the second Sunday. Two candles burning bright, chasing away the darkness from light. Two candles glowing light, the blessings of God giving new sight. This morning I will be reading from Isaiah chapter 11, the first 11 verses. There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his root shall bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what he sees or decide disputes by what he hears, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with a rod from his mouth, and with the breath of his lips He shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and faithfulness the belt of his loins. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the young goat. And the calf and the lion and the fatted calf will be together. And a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, and their young shall lie down together. And the lion shall eat straw like an ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the cobra. And the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. And there shall be no hurt or destroy in all the holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters covers the sea. And in the day that the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal for the peoples, of him shall the nations inquire, and his resting place shall be glorious. In the day that the Lord will extend his hand yet a second time to recover the remnants of his people from Asia and around the world. Amen. This morning the Daughtrys will be lighting our unity candle.
Father, we're most thankful for this opportunity to come to your house this morning and worship. And as we head into the most holy time of the year for us as Christians, we pray that you will keep us mindful of what Christmas is about, the greatest gift that has ever been to mankind. We thank you for sending your Son to die for our sins, and that we will prove worthy for your dedication to us and the promise. These things in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Oh,
Advent, can you hear me? Advent is a season of expectation where we anticipate that day we celebrate as the birth of our Savior. But it doesn't just end with the celebration and anticipation of the birth. We as the body of Christ anticipate that great day when He will return again. Amen? So Advent is more than just a season of celebration for the Christ child, the Messiah, come into the world. But it's also that great anticipation, that celebration that we have every day, that one day our Savior is going to call us to Himself. Amen? Isn't that great news? If you would join me in chapter 4 of the book of Romans, kind of by way of reminder, all of these letters that we're going through are written to people just like who? Well, pretty much just like you, right? How many of y'all are pretty common, wouldn't you say? And so these letters are written to people just like us, but they're also written progressively. In other words, the very first book written in the New Testament is the book of who? The book of James. James wrote the very first book in the New Testament, and it will follow suit. So in your New Testament, they're not really written in the order that you see them. They're written in the order of James, Galatians, 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, and now we're in the book of Romans. So just kind of to go back and get everybody on the same sheet of music, it is now Paul who is having to give some detail to what, as Christians, as the body of Christ, we believe and why we believe it. And so it's a beautiful letter, and if you've been following along the whole time, you realize that as the Christian family, the body of Christ has grown, there's been more and more light that they have received that they can walk by, because now they have, I like to say this a lot because I want you to get it, they did not have what we have that we take for granted, amen? We have the whole Word of God. And here they were sitting in these Gentile churches and these little Jewish churches that have been sprouting up everywhere because of the gospel. They've been eager anticipation, waiting on that word that would come that would help them in their life. And so that's what we are doing this morning, is we're following Paul's argument, if you will, straightening out some things, teaching them some things. But before we get started, let's pray. Father God, we do praise You. You are holy and awesome. And as we slow our minds down, we slow our activities down just a little bit, just so that we can celebrate this season of Your love, and Your mercy, and Your wonderful grace. Lord, we do thank You for the gift of our Savior. Not just His coming, but His coming again. Father, we thank You for that mercy, that love that made it all possible. So, Father, I pray now, help us to understand as they would have, as they would have received, help us to do the same. In Jesus' name, amen. Romans chapter 4, Paul is still speaking to these Jewish believers, trying to help them understand how they have gotten to where they are as the body of Christ. And this is important because even though Paul is the apostle to who? Somebody say it. He's the apostle to the Gentiles. All of these churches are going to have both Jewish believers and Gentile believers all together in one place. And so there's always this tension between these believers because they come from radically different backgrounds. So Paul is trying to help them understand how they got to where they are. And so he's trying to sort out kind of how this has worked out, and in a lot of ways, not the way they thought that it would. The Jews, Paul said earlier, had every advantage. They had the law, they had the priests, they had the prophets, they had the promises of God. And even with all that they had, they still rejected the Messiah when He came as that Son of Man, walked in His earthly ministry. They had everything that pointed to Him, Jim. Everything in their whole culture should have let them realize that this is the Christ. And they still rejected Him. Now, just to stop there for a second, how many of us have friends who have heard the Word of God? They know some of them can recite more about the Word of God than you can, but yet they have still rejected Jesus as Savior. So when we get too hard on these guys, we need to remember we're just about as boneheaded as they are. Amen? And so he's straightening this out. The Jews had every advantage. The earthly kingdom that they anticipated would not come because they rejected Christ. They crucified the Messiah. And they're even going to reject the preaching of the apostles as they're preaching to the same nation of Israel, trying to turn them back to the Messiah. And so the nation of Israel was anticipating an earthly kingdom. And that earthly kingdom would have been established had it not been for their rejection. Do y'all get that? It's important that you understand. These Jews were being told that, you know what? We're the reason this hasn't happened like we were anticipating. And so Paul says, listen, what made them special as the chosen people of God, what made them special, they had circumcision, they had the law, they had the priesthood, and with everything that made them special, Linda, what they turned it into was just ritual and ceremony. Now listen to me, Baptist and Methodist and Pentecostals or whoever you are. If you're not careful, you'll take the very thing that makes us special, which is we are part of the body of Christ. Everybody say amen. We are part of the body of Christ. And if we're not careful, we will turn it into nothing more than ritual and ceremony just like they did. It takes faith to walk, pleases God. Are y'all with me so far? This is important. Paul continues his argument in those first couple of verses. He says, what then shall we say was gained by Abraham? Notice he says, our forefather according to the flesh. For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. Paul says, once again, he's taking them back to that very formation, that very foundation of their faith. He's taking them back to that covenant man. And his name is what, church? Abraham. Father Abraham had many sons, right? And so he's taking these Jewish believers who really are now mixed with these Gentile believers. And he's taking them back to the very root, the very foundation of their faith. He's taking them all the way back to Abraham. But he's also going to have to break some paradigms. Now in Pike County, I don't know that we know what a paradigm is. If you ask somebody for what's a paradigm, they'll give you two dimes, right? I mean, you know. A paradigm is just a way that you look at things and you look at it so long you can't see it any other way. In Pike County, we would call that stinking thinking, right? How many of y'all have ever had stinking thinking at some point in your life? And you know, so the paradigm is they could only see it this way. There's a story I read back in college somewhere, kind of stuck with me. I don't know. A lot of things don't stick with me today. Thank God some of them don't. I mean, you know, but anyway. There was a story of the watch company Rolex, and I'm sure some of you have them. I had a fake one until I broke it, and I was so proud of it because I'd wear it to the pastor's conferences and go, this is what I got for pastor appreciation. It was really a Timex with a Rolex stamp on it. I mean, you know. But they didn't know that. Listen, I don't mind telling you know what I'm saying. All right, so, but the story goes like this. The Swiss company Rolex was approached by another company, wanted them to throw in with the venture and make a little plastic watch that everybody could afford. And Rolex said, who in the world would want to wear a plastic watch? And Casio became Casio. So you see how easy it is to get our thinking in a direction that's not necessarily the right thing. So Paul's having to break these paradigms. And to do that, guys, he takes them all the way back to the foundation of the faith. He's not talking to the Gentile believers now. He's talking to the Jews. All right? Once again, he says, listen, we got to stop thinking about it the way you're thinking about it. Abraham was not justified. Now, if you've taken notes, just put this down. He wasn't put in right standing with God. In right standing is really what we're talking about. He was not put in right standing with God because of his works. And you ought to be thanking God today that it's not about your works, because none of us could work enough to earn our salvation. Amen? I mean, we just couldn't. And so this is hard for these Jewish believers to understand, because all their lives they have been taught that it was about keeping the law. It was about the works of the law. Now, I think it's going to be on the screen, but James chapter 2, verse 24 has just been a problem for all of Christianity. But I want you to understand something. James, the half-brother of Jesus, wrote the very first book in the New Testament, and he's going to tell them, you see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. James is writing to Jews in that very first letter, and the only thing he knew what to tell them was this. Now that you have embraced Messiah, you have to go back to the synagogue and double down in keeping the law. He wasn't telling them something that was wrong. He was telling them the only thing they knew at the time, which was Jewish. If you read the very first chapter, very first verse, he's writing to the 12 tribes of Israel. You cannot earn your salvation. Put that down in your notes now. You cannot work for it. You cannot earn it. Verse 3, Paul continues. He said, "For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness." That's what put him in right standing. Paul puts it back to the very scripture, the very place that they could all recall, which was back in Genesis chapter 15. Abraham believed God, and that's what put him in right standing. Let me ask you a question, and you need to think about this as we go through this little study in chapter 4. How many of you believe God? Do you? Now listen, don't just say it because I ask it. I'll shut my eyes. How many of you believe God? I don't want to see. You know, the problem is we say we do, but do we really believe God? It's important not to just say it. Abraham believed God, and that's what put him in right standing. That word righteousness doesn't mean that he was pure and holy. That just means he was put in the right place. And you know who put him in the right place? God did. Have you ever been put in your place? I have. I've had a few people put me in my place, and it was kind of painful. But you know what? It didn't mean good to know what my place was. So make a note. Let me put you in your place. You didn't earn your salvation. If you're saved today, it's because of the gift of a holy God loving you enough to send his son to die on a cross. Amen? Genesis chapter 15, verse 6, he took them all the way back to what they would have known, they would have studied all the way through their Jewish upbringing. Verse 15, chapter 15 of Genesis, verse 6 says, "And he believed the Lord," and that's what was counted as righteousness. He believed God. Abraham had the simplest, truest form of faith, and that is this: God said it, and he believed it. There used to be a little saying that said, "God said it, I believe it, that settles it." Well, that's just wrong. God said it, that settles it. Now, believing it is optional for you. But now, make sure you understand me. It doesn't change what God said just because you don't believe it. Abraham Anthony believed God, and that settled it. And that's what put him in the right place with God. This was radical to them, but they had to believe that Abraham trusted God, and he takes them back to that place, believing what God said. Now, if you would, make sure you put this in your notes. Believing what God says when it goes against every instinct that you have. Isn't that what happens to us? We know what God said, but I can't see it. I can't feel it. It's just something seems odd about it. Let me tell you something. These senses that we have, and thank God we have them, sight and smell, all those things, will lie to you because we live in a fallen clump of flesh. Amen? And if Abraham had just looked around and said, "This doesn't make sense," let me tell you something. It doesn't have to make sense. If God said it, that settles it. You believe it even when it's not possible to see down the road. I don't know that I want to know what's down the road anymore. How about you? Now, when I was younger, I thought, "Lord, would you just show me? And now I'm sitting here as a kind of an older fella. I'm 39 now, and you know what? I really don't want to know. I went to visit a friend of mine this week who's dying. He called me and asked me if I... This is so weird because, you know, he asked me to do his funeral, and he wanted me to come visit with him for a while. And I told him, I said, "Hank, there's nobody in this world that knows when you're going to leave except the one that puts you in this world. And we'll celebrate that day. We celebrate all of them in between, amen?" And so Abraham, and that's what he's telling these Jews, listen, you got to believe what God says. That's what put Abraham in right standing, even when it didn't seem possible. Even when it doesn't match up with the plan that you have for your life. I've spent a lot of my life giving God some good advice about my life. You know, Lord, I know what you seem to be doing here, Lord, but you know what? It would be so much better if you would do it my way. Have y'all ever prayed that way? Lord, just let me give you a good piece of advice here. Just a nugget, Lord. This is kind of what I want. Let me tell you something. We believe God as the body of Christ even when it doesn't match up with what we want. Are y'all still with me? Now, young people, this is important for y'all because you think you know what you want in life, and I hope and I pray it all turns out exactly like that. But when it takes a left or a right, all you got to know is this: He is still God. When these candles down here burn for Advent, and we are reminded to slow down and celebrate God, and we look around in the coronavirus and the political situation and all this stuff that's come, let me tell you something, that doesn't diminish the truth of God. So we celebrate. Abraham didn't have all that. Look at verse 4 through 8. Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as due. And to the one who does not work but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Just as David also speaks of the blessing of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from his works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. Paul says, listen, the workers get paid what is owed them. It is not a gift. My brother and I worked for a company years ago together, and somehow these people that owned the company thought that they were just doing us some tremendous favor by giving us a paycheck. Have you ever worked for anybody like that? Let me tell you something. We made them money, and we earned ours. Are y'all with me so far? Paul says if you work, that's money that you're owed. The nation of Israel had kept the letter of the law, but they had no faith to go with it. They did what they had to do. I've had people that work for me over the years, and you love these kind of people, don't you? They'll do the bare minimum. Have y'all ever had those people? I mean, if you don't tell them to do this, they'll just sit there and watch somebody else do it. I had a little fellow one time came in for a job interview, and this is just the way people are. Okay, came in and I hired him and I told him what I was going to pay him, and he was so excited. He said, "Can you give me a second?" Brandon, he ran out, got his wife, brought her back in and said, "Tell her what you're going to pay me." And I told her, and they both just did cartwheels out of the office. I'm thinking, I don't know where you've come from, but you didn't get paid much because we're going to keep you poor here anyway. Anyway, this same guy, so excited about what he got paid, found out somebody was working in the same department, made more than him, and the reason he made more than him, because he could do more. And you know that joker quit his job just because he found out somebody else made more money? Isn't that the way people are? Back to the scripture, all right? Anyway, I just thought I'd share that. The nation of Israel, and this is where this is going with Paul, they kept the bare minimum, but they put no faith with it. Are y'all with me so far? That's what he's telling these Jewish believers. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, the writer of Hebrews, which I believe is Paul or one of his associates, way down the road, is going to write these words to the Jews in that day. For good news came to us just as to them, but the message they heard did not benefit them because they were not united by faith with those who listened. Let me tell you something. The nation of Israel, even these Jews who are now Christians, could recite every chapter and verse of the Torah, but they did not have faith. And we have a lot of people in churches today that can recite chapter and verse, but they still have no more faith than those people that don't know one hill of beans about the Word of God. It takes what? Faith. Everybody just say that. It takes faith, not just knowledge up here. So do you still believe God? Are you still holding on to the promise of God? But the believer, Paul said, is counted as righteous in right standing with God because of faith. When I was working this out on the board, I put in right standing, I put the initials IRS, and then I realized that don't bring good things to my mind. But that's really what it is. Our right standing has nothing to do with what we've done. It has everything to do with what he's done. And I say that because we know that to be true, but sometimes we get to thinking that we can mess things up so bad that maybe God can't do something with our lives. Let me tell you something. There is no amount of mess you can have in your life that God can't do something with. I assure you. God is a holy God. It is about faith. Galatians chapter 2, the very first letter written in about 50 AD that Paul wrote. This is the second letter of the New Testament now. They were back then still fighting over the law. We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. You know he's talking to the Jews. Yet we know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. So we also have believed Christ Jesus in order to be justified by what? Faith in Christ, and not by works of the law. Because the works of the law, no one will be justified. From the very beginning of the church, the Gentile believers started to melt into the body of Christ with these Jewish believers, there had to be a separation about how we got here. And Paul, every single turn, every single letter, everything, he goes back to that issue of legalism in the law. Why are they still having this discussion? Because the Jews are still struggling with the same issues. I don't know about you, but I still struggle with some of the things I thought I would be long past by this time in my life. How about you? I mean, I sometimes fall back into, you know, it's mainly my temper, okay? I know y'all think I'm the most peaceful, calm, loving. Y'all do think that, right? But sometimes I can get mad. And if you stand outside the doors of my shop, you might find out more about me than you want to know. But they're struggling with the same issues, and we're a long way down the road. We're 25 plus years down the road, and we're still struggling with it. Well, Paul continues to go back. It was hard for them to take hold of what is and let go of what was. And it's equally hard for us sometimes to let go of things. Any of y'all have trouble letting go? You know, it's easy to let the devil bring that same old mess back into your mind. Well, the reason you're not going to be able to do this, the reason you're not successful in this, the reason you'll never amount to more than this is because of something that happened all those years ago. Can I just give you one word of advice from a person that loves you? Let go of what was and take hold of what is. And that's what Paul's telling these Jewish believers. Yes, you're in the body of Christ. Yes, you're in a family of God. But you didn't get here because of the law that you've kept every year by the letter. You got here by the blood of Jesus. Same way we are. Paul goes back to that same issue. Even toward the end of his own life, that lifelong struggle that is Paul, who was a Jew of Jews, a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was a legalist that had a statue erected to him because he was such a legalist. And God had to break him down at every turn to make him the gospel preacher of grace. He would write in Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 through 14, "But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ." Now, this used to be the guy that was way ahead of his contemporaries in Judaism. I mean, you know, he had hash marks down this side. He had accolades, and he had the little, you know, what when you get the cords on your graduation stuff, you know, like doctorate degrees, I don't know what you call it because I never had one of those cords. Listen, you know, I got out. I wasn't cum laude. I was, thank you, Lordy, I'm outie. I mean, you know, so I never had those things that hang on, the whatever you call them. This was Paul, though. Everything that he had done in his life, everything was about making him that great teacher, that great guy in legalism of the Pharisees. He wanted everybody to hang on every word, just like the old J.P. Morgan commercial. You remember that? When J.P. Morgan speaks, everybody does what? They listen. But his plans didn't work out that way, because on that road to Damascus, something changed his life. And you know what changed his life was when you run head into Jesus, something has to change in your life. Paul says, whatever I gained, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus, Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and not only that, but I count what I've lost as rubbish. You know, sometimes we put so much importance on things that don't matter. You know, sometimes I can look back and I can see where, if I had it to do over again, I wouldn't have spent some of the time I did. I'd have done something different. Y'all know what I'm saying? I wouldn't have spent near as much time around away from my family. I'd have spent more time with my family for all kinds of reasons. So Paul is now an old man. This is shortly before his death. This is one of his prison letters. He says, listen, everything I thought was so important didn't amount to anything. And that's not where you want to wind up. That's not the place you want to wind up in at the end of your life. That's why you have to take stock of it now. I found him, he says in verse 9, and be found in him not having a righteousness of my own that comes through the what? Law. But that which comes through what? Faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. I want you just to think about the mouthful that the man just said. The man who had knew every jot and tittle of the law said, listen, I didn't come to this place in my life because of the law. I came to it by faith in him. Verse 11, that by any means possible, I may obtain the resurrection from death. Not that I've already obtained this or am already perfect. Paul realized that he wasn't perfect. But look what he says. But I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Everybody just say amen. I am so glad I am in Christ. How about you? I am so glad that it doesn't matter what happens on this world, in politics, in viruses, in medical, and all the things that come. I am in Christ. Paul's in prison writing these letters. He is at the end of his life. Now look at verse 13. Brothers, I don't consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do. Please highlight this in your Bible. Forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ. Paul is trying to get them to understand that you cannot take hold of something new until you let go of all that junk that's held you down. Have y'all ever made bad decisions? Have you? I know you have. All of us have. But you can't concentrate on that. Listen, you got to move forward and make better ones. You've got to move forward and spend more time considering the very thing that Paul's telling them. You got to let go of the past and you got to take hold of the future now. Are y'all with me so far? Paul's not beating these guys up. He loves the nation of Israel. Verse 9 through 12, Paul continues, is this blessing then only for the circumcised, the Jews, or is it also for the uncircumcised, the Gentiles? For we say that faith was counted to Abraham as righteousness. How then was it counted to him? Was it before or after he had been circumcised? Again, back to the argument that goes to Abraham. It was not after, but it was before he was circumcised. He received the sign of circumcision as a seal of righteousness, that he had faith while he was still uncircumcised. The purpose was to make him the father of all, Jews and Gentiles, who believe without being circumcised, so that the righteousness would be counted to them as well, and to make him the father of the circumcised, who are not merely circumcised but also walk in his footsteps, of the faith that our father Abraham had before he was circumcised. In other words, these promises that God made to Abraham occurred before there was ever the law. before there was ever that thing that made a distinction. The promise was for all humanity. You've heard me say this, but it helps you if you will understand this. What should have happened was this. By Abraham, the nation of Israel was a path, a conduit for the redeeming blessings of God. What should have happened is when the Messiah came, the nation of Israel should have embraced him. And the earthly kingdom would have been established. Now, he would have still been crucified by the Romans, but it wouldn't have been by the Jews. Because it always took what? Always took blood. Then the earthly kingdom would have been established. The nation of Israel would have become a nation of priests, and they would have gone out and shared the gospel, the good news of Messiah. But that did not happen because they rejected him. And so what we see now is the promise that was made to Abraham, that right standing is going to have to be fulfilled through that person of Paul. He's the one that's going to take the gospel to the nations because Israel has failed. Does that make sense to y'all? What should have happened was what God had promised the whole time, what he said the nation would be the whole time. But the nation of Israel rejected their Messiah. Verse 14 and 15. For if it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings what, guys? It brings wrath. But where there is no law, there's no transgression. If just the law could have saved, then you wouldn't need the sacrifice of Jesus. If just the law could have saved you, you wouldn't have need salvation through the blood of Christ. But Abraham was not found in right standing because of the law. The promise was made before the law was even given, because the law brings wrath. Galatians chapter 4, Paul wrote in that, again, that very first letter, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son born of a woman. Now, I want to stop there just for a second. We celebrate the Advent season. We celebrate the what kind of birth of Christ? The virgin birth. How many of you really believe in this church this morning that Jesus was born of a virgin? Do you believe that this morning? Listen, that's what we're celebrating. You know, I don't care that a lot of the Christian world today says, well, you know, I believe that was just kind of metaphorical, that Mary wasn't really a virgin. I don't know that that was really a serious statement. It was just something that was, let me tell you something. If the Word of God says Mary was a virgin when Jesus was born, that's what she was. Are y'all still with me? We don't celebrate some fable. We celebrate a holy God. We celebrate that Savior. God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law. He came first to the Jews, and then it would be for the world, the Gentiles, so that we might receive adoption as sons, to take them out from under the law and put them in their rightful place. Earlier, Paul had said the nation of Israel was under a tutor, a nanny, a keeper that was called the law. But once Jesus came, now listen, this is exciting. Once Jesus came, you didn't have to have a tutor, a nanny anymore. You were put in your place. We're supposed to take that place. Verse 16 and 17, that's why it depends on faith, Paul says. In order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his offspring, not only to the adherent of the law, but also to the one who shares the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations in the presence of God, in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Paul takes it back to the very beginning at every turn. I believe that literally everything that you see, everything that's ever been, God spoke it and it was. Do y'all believe that? I don't care if some knot-headed scientist comes up and says that you were formed when two little amoebas have run into each other or whatever, and they somehow formed a fish, and the fish somehow got legs, and the legs somehow came, you know, became a monkey and climbed up in a tree, and that's your ancestors. Well, I have some that look like that, but that ain't true. God made it the way it is. Are y'all with me so far? And so much of the Christian community reads the account of creation and they somehow go, well, okay. I mean, it ain't okay. I believe that Jesus was born of a virgin, and I believe that God created everything that he exists today. That's important. Is that important to y'all? Well, that's exactly what Paul's taking them back to. It depends on that kind of faith. It depends on that kind of relationship with God. Everything about it. Abraham is the father of all. As I have written, I have made you the father of many nations in the presence of God, in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls everything into existence. That's why it depends on faith. The promise rests on God's grace. I don't know about you, but I am super, super thankful for the grace of God. How about you? I'm thankful for his love. Because what we really deserved was wrath and punishment. And I thank God that through the blood of Jesus, I no longer have to worry about God's wrath and judgment. I stand in the presence of God through the wonderful lens of the blood of Jesus. How about you? And I look a whole lot better through the blood of Jesus than I look without it. Amen? So do you. Paul takes them all the way back, and it was always guaranteed to all who believe. Everybody just say all. This isn't about some are saved and some are not saved from the beginning of time. Listen, everybody has the opportunity to put their faith in the Jesus that went to Calvary to die for your sins, was buried in a grave, rose from the grave, and sits at the right hand of the Father because he is God. Now, what you do with that information is up to you. But Paul says it's always been about God's grace, always guaranteed first to the Jew and then to the Gentile. Like Paul is saying, if we concentrate, guys, on what makes us different, these Jewish believers in this church and these Gentile believers, if we keep going back to what makes us different, we'll miss the most important thing. Clarence and I were talking this past week. If you want to get past racism, you got to quit talking about racism. If you want to get past looking at people the way that everybody else looked at them, you got to look at them like you should. That's my brother. It doesn't matter whether he's brown, black, green, or purple. If we talk about what makes us different, we'll never get to where we should be. Is that fair enough for y'all? Every time Clarence comes into my office, I always ask him, do you want some coffee? I'll make you some. He says, no, I'm black enough. He's never offered me coffee, so I don't know whether he's trying to what. I mean, I don't know. For the Jews, these Jewish believers who, hey, guys, they're having a hard time letting go of being Jews. Paul's made it over and over. He said there is no longer Jew or Gentile. It's just one in the body of Christ. You keep going back to the things that make you different, you'll never resolve the issue. But what's important is what makes us the same, and that is God's grace. Are y'all with me so far? It is God's grace. It is the gospel. It is what Abraham, that man of faith, is that simple, pure act of faith that says, God said it, and I believe it. It's not about what you see. It's not about what happens to you just because you want it. It's because God said it. Verse 18, Paul continues. He said, in hope he believed against hope, that he should become the father of many nations, as he had been told, so shall his offspring be. Paul goes back to that dynamic that existed with Abraham. Abraham, put this in your notes. Abraham had no reason to believe what God said by what he could see. He had no reason to believe by those things that he could physically reach out and touch and think. So Paul asked them to do the same. And you know what? That's what preachers, Tim, over and over throughout the ages have asked their congregations to do. And I'm asking you today, put your faith in God when it doesn't make sense. Put your faith in God because he's God. And that's what his word says. It doesn't matter what you go through. I can remember that, you know, you don't want to be flippant, but when they asked me in Omaha if I watched the video about what they were going to do to me with the bone marrow transplant, I said, no. And they said, well, you were supposed to watch it. I said, I don't want to watch it. I said, just give me 10 minutes notice so I can get a cigarette and go to the bathroom. I mean, I don't smoke, don't get me wrong. But my point was this. Don't tell me what you're going to do to me. I'm resting in the hands of a holy, awesome God. I don't need you to tell me what you... He's just going to be there with me. Does that make sense? I don't mean that to be flippant. There's some people in this church going through some terrible things. I mean, Jill Johnson, we got some people. You know what? I've told them all the same thing, haven't I, Erica? It's about being right here in His hands when it doesn't make sense, when you can't see it. Verse 19 says that he didn't weaken in the faith when he considered it his own body, which was 100 years old. I love to read that story because, you know, that's pretty good to be 100 years old. Even though his body was worn out, and there's a reason why, because you know what? Everybody had to look at that old man with that old wife, even though she was pretty hot. He had to lie about who she was. Only God could do that. Y'all with me so far? Only God could do that. Let me tell you something. The only reason I can stand here today is for the same reason. Only God. Only God. Verse 20, Paul says, no amount of unbelief made him waver concerning the promises of God. He grew strong in his faith. That's what it ought to happen. When we encounter things, you know, I've told y'all many times, I don't like talking a lot about the military stuff, but it's better that I do because somebody needs to hear it. I certainly don't like talking about the cancer stuff, but it's better for some people to hear me say it. My life experience that God's brought me through makes the difference. Guess what? Yours does too. Yours does too. Don't be so shy about going. I've been through some difficult times. No amount of doubt. None of it made him shrink in his faith. It just made him give glory to God. It made him strong. He had nothing to validate it. He had nothing but simple faith to keep it and give glory to God. Now, if you notice, it says that he was fully convinced. Make sure you mark that down, because we're getting to the end of this thing. I want you to get it. He was fully convinced that God was able. You might as well end that sentence right there. How many of you are absolutely fully convinced that God is able to keep what he said he's going to do? Do you believe that this morning? Even when the news doesn't tell you that it's good, even when your friends are going through their tough times, let me tell you something. If you're fully convinced that God is able, your life will be different. You don't worry about things anymore like you used to. You don't have to. Amen? God is able. I'm not able. I love that. He said he was fully convinced. Oh, verse 23, but the word that was counted to him were written not for his sake alone. I'm glad there was some forethought into that. But for ours also, it will be counted to us who believe in him who raised from the dead Jesus our Lord, who delivered up for our trespasses and raised him for our justification, our right standing. Not just for him, but ours. For all who believe the gospel. That's what Paul's trying to get them to do. Is break those paradigms in their thinking and take hold of something new, not just the past. To quit being Jewish, to quit being pagans, and to be the body of Christ that they were intended to be. And you know what, guys? If we're going to move forward and strong in the faith, we've got to do the same thing. We have got to be fully convinced that our God is able. Now, we can't live in the past. We can't live in yesterday. We've got to live today and tomorrow convinced that God is who he is. Are y'all with me so far this morning? Father God, I praise you for the same exact reason Paul did. You are worthy of praise. And there is no amount of dishevelment in this world. There's no amount of drama in my life that changes who you are. And all the people in this room, Father God, I pray that you bring us to that place where we have to answer that question. Do we believe what you've said? In Jesus' name, amen.